So a very good afternoon to all of you and a warm welcome in today's webinar entitled as Role of Sequencing in SARS-CoV-2 Discovery, Diagnostic and Disease Surveillance. With emergence of newer mutants of SARS-CoV-2 and the emergence of defined clades, genome sequencing of the virus is going to play a very vital role in diagnostics, monitoring and surveillance of COVID-19 disease spread, and it will be help in strategic preparedness and responsive plan for the effective management of the disease. Next generation sequencing, which is throughput, has a potential to identify even minuscule amount of the viral signature against the background of the human genome in raw sample, as well as it can quickly assemble and identify the whole genome of novel viruses. A de novo approach, which is going to help even a lot of other techniques like RT-PCR to effectively make a primer probe based pair and rapidly roll out to across the world, as we have seen in the case of this particular pandemic. So today we have two prominent speakers from CSIR Institute of Genomics and Integrative Biology, who are at the forefront of sequencing of COVID-19 genomes. They will share their detailed insight on it. We have Dr. Sridhar Shivasubbu. He is a senior principal scientist at IGIB, and his research interests are focused on sequencing human genome for adoption and benefit in healthcare with applications in rare genetic disorders. He also develops Gibraphis model for application in precision medicine in humans. Dr. Shivasubbu completed his PhD from MS University and his postdoc research from CSIR CCMB, as well as University of Minnesota, USA, with a specialization in genetics and genomics. He has more than 100 publications and have a great insight on technology development and commercialization. He has introduced two big technologies along with 28 molecular diagnostic assays as commercialized product. We also have Dr. Vinod Sakaria. Dr. Sakaria is a clinician, turned computational biologist. His research interests are in understanding the functional, organizational, and regulational role of different components in vertebrate genome and how genomics variation could potentially impact them. His research has contributed to a number of insight and technologies which are widely being used in India for diagnosis and screening of genetic disorders. He has also been the part of early whole genome sequencing population genomics projects, including the Indian, Sri Lankan, as well as Malaysian genome project, and is a member of Hugo Pan-Asia Population Genomics Task Force. Dr. Vinod has over more than 170 publications in international peer-reviewed journals, and he is in board of multiple editorial board of prestigious journals like PLOS ONE and Journal of Translational Medicine. He also have authored two books. Dr. Vinod is recipient of CSIR Young Scientist Award for Biological Sciences, Cowley Frontier Science Fellow for U.S. National Academy of Science in 2015, and an elected fellow of Royal Society of Biology. Dr. Shivasubbu and Dr. Vinod, both are co-founders of the Genomics for Understanding Rare Diseases India Alliance Network, that is Guardian, which is one of the largest precision medicine ecosystem in India, working on rare genetic disorders. And it's indeed a very important field, because in those cases which are rare, the solutions are very limited, even in terms of, you know, information, as well as even in terms of tests like that. There are only esoteric tests which are not widely available and not everybody is offering. So in today's webinar, Dr. Sridhar and Dr. Vinod take us through science behind SARS-CoV-2 sequencing, effective quality control measures, and molecular contact tracing, while highlighting the role of genomic variation in strategic planning of the disease management. The webinar will be recorded. I'm sure it's going to be a great learning experience for all of us. I request Dr. Sridhar to kindly start the session and discuss upon the wet lab aspects of COVID-19 sequencing. Thank you.
Thank you, Prashant, for the great introduction, and thank you, Team Find, for organizing this nice webinar, very timely webinar that I would say, in terms of the genomics of SARS-CoV-2, which is sort of taking over after almost a year of high-end work that we did on controlling the webinar. I think it's time that we looked at genomics as a tool for surveillance and genetic epidemiology. And please allow me to share my screen. 1 minute. Yes. Prashant, is my screen visible? Can somebody just
sure. Sure. Certainly, we can have a look on it. We can watch.
Great.
It.
Thank you. So throughout about a year since we have been actively trying to pursue and control SARS-CoV-2 epidemic, there have been a number of tools that have been deployed, tested, and I personally have not seen science being discussed so much in society as well as being deployed at the speed at which I've seen in the last 1 year. And one of the technologies that has been really been around for almost about 2 decades since the early 2000s was the next generation sequencing. Though it began formally only in about 2004, the technology has been around in experimental paradigms. So it was very heartening to see how the next generation sequencing came to aid and was applied in the area of SARS-CoV-2. And that's what my talk is going to about, is about high throughput detection of SARS-CoV-2 using COVID-seq as a method, which is a next generation sequencing method. And how do we derive insights into surveillance and genetic epidemiology? And this work that I'm presenting is a large collaborative work, not only in terms of science, but also in terms of resilience of people, because it brought out the best in the team across India, and that too in very pressing times. With that, let me start. So SARS-CoV-2, this has become a very common knowledge now that was a causative organism of COVID-19 pandemic. It's an RNA-based virus, about 30,000 bases in terms of its size, with a potential outbreak that happened out of China. So this is the background most of us are aware about. But what really pertains to the discussion that we are having today about SARS-CoV-2 is that this was genomics meeting virology. This is not the first time that the viruses are getting sequenced, but sequenced in real time. Nowhere before this has this been applied in such a large scale, where in real time we could get data and we could use genomics not only as an experimental tool, but as a solution provider. And that is what this last 1 year really taught us. So how do you use genomics? One, you could use genomics to understand the sequences of mixed genomes. For example, you have a co-infection with several viruses and other pathogens. You could delineate what is the causative organism. And this is something that at IGAB, Vinod, myself, and other team members have been practicing for quite a number of years with other pathogens. And this is something that we had developed about 7 years ago as a tool. But the other area where genomics has really helped is using this along with high-end computational biology to make sense of what are those group of pathogens. So real-time genomics in virology is something that really got applied during this pandemic. And I think that was very heartening to see that happening. So how do you go about sequencing a virus in case of SARS-CoV-2? In this particular case, you could take saliva swabs, swabs or nasopharyngeal swabs, saliva swabs, or the bronchial lavage, extract RNA out of it. And usually the RNA would contain a lot of ribosomal component. One would deplete that component using specific techniques that are now very popular, and then subject them to a next generation sequencing platform. There are quite a number of platforms that are now very popularly employed in sequencing viruses, and use these platforms for RNA sequencing. And then comes the job of base calling. Okay, using computational tools to understand the composition. There's a number of tools that are used, that are very popularly used. And at the end, you would be able to derive out what is the phylogenetic analysis or what is the composition of this virus and where does it fit into the larger picture. So today's talk will be divided into two parts. One, I'll be taking you out from right from the sample all the way to sequence and how do you make sense of it. Whereas what Vinod would do, my colleague who will be talking right after me, will really go after the computational nitty-gritties on how do you get the make sense of the data. So that's how we have divided the talk. Now, before I go ahead and talk about the genomics, I would really want you to understand something very important. Genomics is very useful to document mutations. And mutations are by the means by which we are able to track the viruses. They are sort of the genetic signatures. Okay. For example, in this particular case, the SARS virus has a modest substitution rate. It's actually slower than the seasonal flu. It has a substitution rate of about 3.7 bases that get changed every month, or roughly you could say 4 bases a month, you could see a change. So for example, if you had a virus within about 7 days, okay, it could accumulate a mutation, and this mutation might happen randomly. It's a natural evolution process, but it provides you a nice signature. Now, once in a while, as this happens, this might lead to a completely new strain or a new lineage. And sometimes these new lineages might also lead to a highly infectious variety of the virus, which might lead to an outbreak. Okay. So what genomics allows you to do is to develop signatures through which you could do molecular contact tracing or ancestry tracing. Okay. That's what genomics allows you to do. So while techniques such as RT-PCR and other methods only give you a yes or a no answer, they're good for detection, genomics goes one step further, also allows you to do the contact tracing very efficiently. And that's what I will demonstrate during the second half of my talk. Okay. Now, having said this, what does genome sequencing help us in? It helps us in the evolution of the circulating virus. Okay. Understanding how did the virus evolve, where did it evolve, what is its current formation, and so on and so forth. Second, it provides a confirmation of the virus. Okay. It provides you a genetic confirmation of the virus because you're able to read out the genetic composition. It helps you understand the origin of the infection. Of course, it helps you pinpoint the source of the outbreak. So these are all some of the very important aspects that genome sequencing help us. Of course, it does help us in designing new diagnostics, vaccines, and therapies. We'll not be dealing about this part, at least in my talk. We'll restrict us to the first four. So now coming back to COVID in India, okay, the first case of confirmed case happened to be out of a person traveling from China to the state of Kerala. That was in the year, end of January, 30th January. And as you see in my slide, you can see the timelines. By April, we had about 2,000 confirmed cases. And by December, we all know the case histories now. Closer to about 97 lakhs with over 1,40,000 deaths. Now, so if you look at such a map, what did genome sequencing do to India? Is to allow molecular contact tracing. That's all it did. It allowed you to look for signatures of each of these patients carrying these viral signatures and allowed you to say, how did the virus go from one end of the country to the other end of the country? And this slide is only to introduce you to the concept of molecular contact tracing. Vinod, during his talk, okay, would elaborate upon how does this, the nitty-gritties of this contact tracing actually happen. I'm not going to deal about it. Okay. Now, coming to the core talk, okay, about early April, May, June, okay, at CSIR or IGIB, we had toyed with this idea. Instead of doing genomics with singleton viral samples, at some time point, okay, as the epidemic grows and goes out of proportion, you will need high throughput methods. Okay. And that's where the next generation sequencing technology was rightly poised. It could do large number of genome sequencing simultaneously and analyze them in parallel and be able to really do contact tracing. Okay. So we knew this was going to happen, given the scale of the epidemic. So we set about setting up a program called CSIR Megalab program, in which we tested a number of ideas and we worked with a number of companies. And I'm going to talk about one of our experiences, the Illumina COVID-Seq test. This happened to be the first NGS test that was approved by the FDA. And we got the opportunity to do the first global clinical validation for COVID-Seq at IGIB. And my colleagues who participated along with Vinod are shown in pictures here. Fantastic team led by Rahul, Abhinav and his team members. And I really appreciate for the efforts that they put in during the pandemic. Now, so the first thing that we did was to do with direct human-to-human contact. That was through digital engagement of volunteers. So we built apps around it. We did digital reporting and self-sampling. This is something that we started doing so that we could have long-term follow-up and scalability. And here is the COVID-seq protocol at a glance. You could collect samples using self-sampling. You had an app through which all the data was reported and communication happened. And this came into the lab where you would do library preparation, which is something that is an integral part to next generation sequencing. That means you'd shred the virus into small bits and put in very specific DNA based adapters, which are known adapters, and then subject them to genome sequencing using platforms such as the NovaSeq 6000 from Illumina, and then subject them to computational analysis. So in result, you could generate just over about 3,000 samples in under 12 hours on a Illumina NovaSeq 6000. That is the throughput that that we attempted to achieve. And I'll show you about how we went about doing it. Now, looking at the workflow for COVID-seq, you could take patient samples in terms of a nasopharyngeal swab or an oropharyngeal swab or just a nasal sample or in a regular VTM. It is also amenable to a number of isolation methods that is popularly used using the automated one or the QIAGEN or the TruPrep or the standard laboratory-based TriZol methods. You could use any of them. We have tested all these methods and all of them work equally well. These were subjected to library preparation and pooling. There is some amount of technicalities here because you are handling about 3,000 samples simultaneously. And if you can, this is also subjected to a lot of automation, but it could also be done manually. Now, this all goes into a flow cell. You'd make library pools, put it onto a flow cell, and the flow cell goes into the sequencers. And in about less than 12 hours, you get the output in terms of FASTA files. Now, these FASTA files are subjected to two sets of analysis. One is an automated analysis that the Illumina supplies called the DRAGEN COVID-seq pipeline, and that gives you a detection report. Okay, and this is an FDA-approved report. The second is a little more exhaustive report that actually Vinod will talk about in terms of variant calling and phylogenetic analysis that allows you to do a lot of molecular contact tracing. We'll talk about both of them. So in essence, it's a scalable platform that can handle from 300 samples to about 3,000 samples at any given time point. Okay, all you need to change is the type of flow cell. It can go from 300 to 3,000 samples. Now, here is the proof of concept that we did for COVID-seq when we did the first global field validations. We had taken 752 samples in duplicates that were run on a NovaSeq S4 flow cell. Okay. Now, these 752 samples in duplicates were taken primarily so that we would have internal controls and you'd know the reproducibility of the data. Okay. Therefore, they were taken in duplicates. Now, of these 752 samples, they were again divided into confirmed positives on RT-PCR, confirmed negative on RT-PCRs, confirmed inconclusive on RT-PCRs, and the pan-serboco positives as defined by ICMR criteria. So we had all the classes. We had also divided the 752 samples based on the CT value cutoffs, okay, just to see what was the threshold that we could get very good results for. So we had all the classes that normally you would get in a lab. And like I said, it was 752 into 2, so making it just over 1,500 samples that could go on a S4 flow cell. Now we ran the COVID-seq assay, the next generation sequencing, and also the analysis. So we could generate about 705 GB of data with a very good Q30 cutoff. About 95.6% of the samples had Q30 cutoff, which is a very good criteria for sequencing. Most important points to note here is that the sensitivity of this assay was 98.4 and accuracy was 97.29 vis-a-vis the gold standard at that point, which was RT-PCR. And the time taken was 12 hours. Now, of these 700 odd samples, we could generate whole genome sequencing for 469 samples, while rest of the samples had some parts of the genome missing, but they were good for detection. So you could get about 98.4% of the samples that could be detected. Okay, about 469 samples, you could get the complete 30,000 bases. Okay, in terms of its genome sequencing. And this data has already been in public domain. For those of you who are interested, there is a publication given at the bottom of the screen, which is a preprint, and data is available. So feel free to go through it. So one of the first things that we noticed was this genome sequencing using COVID-seq helps us to identify false negatives on RT-PCR, because several labs in July through almost December were complaining about false negativities in RT-PCR. And we could hereby use sequencing, which is an orthogonal method, and reclassify them as positives. So giving us an additional diagnostic gain of about 8 to 10%. Okay, and shown here at the panel here are the reads pertaining to the genomes that were obtained, because these RNA are also of diverse quality. So not all of them are of great quality, but nevertheless, we could get very good reads in bits and pieces, and we could know that these all belong to the SARS-CoV-2 genomes. You could also build genetic epidemiology of SARS-CoV-2 using the samples that we had obtained from the 752 samples that we had obtained. And this was a fantastic work chipped in by Bani and Vinod, wherein they could build these nice tools where we would be able to look at all the lineages, be able to identify which lineages are dominating at which time point of the epidemic, and use that for driving public health decisions. I'll show how it was used in a real life case. So in summary, this ultra high throughput sequencing method has a very high sensitivity and has an additional advantage of enabling genetic epidemiology of SARS-CoV-2. In this particular case, we had taken samples from 7 states, over 2000 genome sequenced, of which about just over 1000 had very good full-length genome sequencing coverages available that were subjected to additional informatics analysis, allowing us to report 2 lineages for the first time from India. And this data is available in public domain. And now this particular platform has been adopted by the recently announced strategy for the countrywide 5% positive samples that are getting sequenced. They would go through the COVID-seq protocol as one of the protocols, and this happens to be the benchmarking for it that allowed it to happen. Now, in summary, it's a scalable platform. COVID-seq is a scalable one. We could do 300 to 3,000 samples in batches of 300, 1,500, or 3,000 samples. It had better sensitivity compared to conventional RT-PCR. But please remember, it is not a replacement for RT-PCR. It is an add-on to the RT-PCR platform. It gave you additional diagnostic yield. But most importantly, 50% of the pan-SARS-CoV samples that we had checked actually got reclassified as COVID-19 positives, which was something that we had to deal with as a public health initiative. It's very important information. And this could be used to drive genetic epidemiology of the infection. I will show you how this happened. Now, here is a case study that I would like to take from the experiences that we had when we worked with the government of Kerala to see how could we use COVID-seq as an assay to look for contact tracing and driving public health initiatives. Like all of us know, Kerala is a well-organized healthcare system and gets a lot of inflow of both people who travel in and out of India and tourists. So it was an ideal case for us to use COVID-seq in this particular state. Along with the Government Medical College, Kozhikode, Kerala, we sampled 200 samples from the month of August. And from the 200 samples, 179 genomes were sequenced, and of which 130 were of really high quality that we could use for drawing conclusion. So one of the first conclusions that we drew was, when we looked at the 100 plus samples, all of them came out of one clade, which is the A2A clade, which was very surprising given the amount of tourist inflow, the people who came from abroad, across from Middle East, from Southeast Asia into Kerala when the epidemic started. It was surprising to see that Kerala only had a monophyletic distribution of clade. You are expected it to be the really a diversity. We didn't see that. Remember, Kerala got its first patient in the country in February, and we're talking about August. Still, we only have a monophyletic distribution. That tells a lot about the public health infrastructure. I'll comment upon it later. Okay. The other discovery that we had was the two variants, D614G and L5F in the S gene were found in pretty high numbers in the genomes that we sequenced. Okay. And these variants have been associated with high infectivity as shown by multiple studies internationally. So they had a viral strain that was highly infective. That was the second information that we could derive. Third information that we could derive was there are three major introductions in Kerala. Okay. So here is the phylogenetic map. That's the map for all the other states that we have. And these are the three outbreaks that happened in Kerala. Okay, the clusters K1, okay, is basically an introduction that happened from the state of Maharashtra. Okay, basically a local introduction from a neighboring state. A K2 cluster that was an introduction from an mostly out of Orissa, we think, and a K3 cluster from an introduction from a travel from Karnataka. Okay, so this is the kind of information one can obtain when you have genome sequencing and be able to do molecular contact tracing. And we were able to do because we had samples out of all pretty much all the states that's lifted out of here that is available to us. Now, the fourth thing that we also noticed was using genomics, we could also identify recent but not apparently connected outbreaks spanning multiple districts. Okay, as seen here, these outbreaks independently were treated separately, but when we could do genomics around it, we realized that all of them were connected outbreaks. However, these were not this information. If it had been available in time to the healthcare authorities, they could have taken a different strategy. Okay, so it allows us to do molecular contact tracing and connect unconnected outbreaks. So how did Kerala government use this for enabling pandemic policy decisions? They took three decisions, okay, that could really come out. One, the health authorities knew that they were dealing with a highly infective strain of the virus, so they could suggest aggressive measures to curb the measures of quarantine and others to curb the virus spread. Second, very important observation that came out of this was that genome sequencing suggested that it was interstate rather than international introductions that had contributed to the extensive amount of infection in the state, suggesting that the strategies for testing, tracing, and quarantine of international travels were quite successful. Remember, I told you that in spite of getting its first case in February, till August, okay, they only pretty much had most of the contributions from interstate, not from international travelers. That was a very good contact tracing and quarantine measures that they had put in place in all the airports and the seaports. Third, they could really connect and find relationship between apparently unrelated clusters. Thereby, focused contact tracing could be done and be able to close down locally the potential hotspots and thereby have a science-driven policy to take public health measures, not just a large-scale policy that is not supported by science. And all this was made possible only because of fantastic collaboration with the Government Medical College at Kozhikode, Kerala. So now this was done in August. So what has happened since August is Government of Kerala partnered with IGIV to realize the power of genomics. And today we have a genetic epidemiology of SARS-CoV-2 in Kerala, which is a full-fledged program that runs in all 14 districts where every month samples are collected, 100 samples per district comes to IGIV, gets genome sequenced, gets reported back to Kerala government for taking policy health decisions. So you could see how genomics is in the forefront of driving pandemic policy, public health decisions. And this would not have been possible without the advancements in genomics that we have put in place. So along with the Government of Kerala, National Health Mission and IGIV, we have managed to stitch together an ideal program which is suited for the state of Kerala. And we are in discussion with several other states to put similar scientific programs in place so as to curb the spread of the virus. With that, I will stop and acknowledge a large number of fantastic team members at IGIV led by Rahul Boyer, Abhinav Jain, Paras, Mohit, Disha, and several other really capable and very good individuals whom I have the privilege to work with. Several of them are my own students. And of course, Vinod Skaria, who happened to provide us the fantastic informatics and medical support to keep ourselves working during the pandemic. A team of about more than 50 IJB volunteers that made sure we remain open throughout the pandemic without closing down even for a day. Of course, fantastic collaboration from several government hospitals across the country and the IndiCovGen consortium. And all this would not be possible had CSIR not invested into genomics early on into the epidemics, and fantastic support and funding from CSIR. With that, I will stop and hand over the talk to Vinod. Thank you. I'll take questions after Vinod's talk. Vinod, to you.
Am I visible and audible?
Yes, Vinod.
Yeah. Thank you for the invitation and taking over from where Sridhar left. What I'm going to talk about in the next 20 minutes or so is what we can additionally glean from genome sequences of SARS-CoV-2. Now, all that we know about SARS-CoV-2 genome is also thanks to the genome sequences which were made available early in the pandemic. And the first genome sequence of SARS-CoV-2 was made available as early as February 2020. We're almost a year of arriving at this genome sequence. Now, what is really pertinent while analyzing genome sequences of SARS-CoV-2 is the fact that it is an RNA virus, and RNA viruses have a quite significant rate of genetic variability. And this genetic variability in terms of acquiring new genetic mutations have a constant rate. And this constant rate is estimated approximately one genetic mutation every 7 to 10 days. Now, practically all that we do in terms of genetic epidemiology, in terms of looking at genetic variants, in terms of looking at functional genetic variants, in terms of contact tracing, so on and so forth, is all dependent upon this very, very basic principle that the virus mutates and this mutation occurs at a pretty constant rate. Just to exemplify this point, let me just draw attention to the early genome sequences which are available of SARS-CoV-2 from across China. The Wuhan Huan, or the first genome, which I sort of mentioned in the earlier slide, was collected in December 26th. And as we moved to, for example, January 8th, another sample which was sequenced and deposited in public domain had an additional nucleotide change, and so on and so forth. It kept accumulating nucleotide changes or substitutions, which adds to the repertoire of genetic variability for this virus. Now, the epidemic investigations, or what we call as a forensics of the epidemic, can essentially be performed by looking at virus sequences at points in time. So what you see here as the vertical planes are essentially points in time. And as you see here, the virus would mutate and diverge at different points in time as the virus moves from host to host or from person to person, transmitting the infection across the world. Now, since the virus mutates at a constant rate, you expect at any point in time all the distinct genetic variants or variable lineages to be present at a constant fashion or an equiproportional fashion. That's not really what really happens, because at some points in time, you would have one or the other lineages of the virus, lineages loosely defined by sets of genetic mutations which come together. They come in disproportionate numbers at some points in time. Now, these events are what we call as emergence events. And these emergence events could be because of host factors, either, for example, because of a super spreader event or because of genetic factors which makes the virus more fit to transmit or survive across the human population. Now, this is very important because you could also look at different points in time across a spectrum, do sequencing to understand how did a particular genetic lineage come up, or how did a particular genetic lineage perform in terms of the human interventions that have been made at different points in time. Now, if you really go back to the phylogenetic tree of SARS-CoV-2 across the world, this is pretty much the old nomenclature that we follow from the next strain classification. Largely, there were around 10 different clades or genetic lineages of SARS-CoV-2. And as you see here, some lineages or clades are in larger proportions compared to others. Now, early in the epidemic, many of these genetic lineages roughly translated to the geographical origins of the virus as it spread across the world. The B superclade, which includes the B1, B2, and B4, largely were from China and Southeast Asia. And of course, the A2A, which today is the predominant clade across the world, was originally derived from Europe. And therefore, early in the pandemic, you could look at the genetic lineage of the virus and sort of figure out from where in the world did those introductions happen. But of course, at a later point of time, this is not really possible because as I will come to in a few slides from now, some genetic lineages become extremely disproportionately large that you cannot use this information anymore for looking at introductions. Now, coming back to India, India has done quite well in terms of genome sequencing, thanks to a large number of researchers and institutions, which put together close to around 6,300 odd genomes of SARS-CoV-2, practically encompassing the length and breadth of the country. And this has been made possible by multiple institutions and multiple funding bodies who have funded these researchers to make available these genome sequences. I'll also point to this very interesting resource that we have sort of put together called Indico, where you could go back and sort of search through the genetic variants in SARS-CoV-2, which are present in India, and also be able to make useful assessments about how frequent or less frequent are each of these genetic variations in the genomes that are present. Now, there are a variety of things that you can learn from genome sequences of SARS-CoV-2. One is, of course, to understand the evolution in terms of how does the virus mutate. The second is to, of course, understand the origin of infection or the spread of infection in an outbreak. And of course, more importantly, to also evaluate diagnostics and vaccines. I will briefly touch upon each of these points as we go forward. Now, if you look at the genetic lineages in India, the genetic lineages in India are pretty much smaller than what you see across the world. Out of the 10 or so genetic lineages, as per the old next strain classification, we have around 6 genetic lineages which map to the global genetic lineages. Now, apart from the 6, we have an additional genetic lineage, which we sort of call as IA3I, because it was never found as a genetic lineage or a distinct genetic lineage elsewhere in the world in large proportions. Now, this genetic lineage is called or was named as I because it was distinctly large in India, and A3I because it had some genetic variants which were shared with the A3 genetic lineage. And the A3 genetic lineage early in the pandemic were essentially genetic lineages which arose out of Iran. Now, we could also go back and look at the proportions of these genetic lineages across different states in India. And what you see here is quite remarkable. The IA3I and the A2A are largely the predominant genetic lineages across the different states. And even between states, you could have very distinctly different proportions of genetic lineages. For example, these genetic lineages were very large in proportion in, for example, Delhi, in, for example, Telangana, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, and so on and so forth. But minor proportions of these genetic lineages of IA3I was found in many other states. You could not find any of the IA3I genetic lineage in, for example, states like Kerala and some states in the northeast region. Now, you could also look at the forensics of this genetic lineage to sort of understand in points in time, how did this emerge? And what you see in the right-hand side of the slide is essentially the timescale map of this genetic lineage, which sort of suggests that this genetic lineage was created by a sort of super spreader event focused in time and space, and then therefore, after the super spreading event, was spread across different states in the country. So these are the things that you could sort of understand in terms of the dynamics of the virus and spread of the virus, not just in genetic lineages, but also across in terms of how it evolved across the country. Now, when I say that the viruses do have a constant rate of genetic mutation, you could now classify genetic mutation frequencies across different genetic lineages. And what I show here is that the IA3I genetic lineage has a significantly lower mutation frequency or the substitution rate of approximately 1.19 newton to the power minus 3 substitutions per base per year compared to 1.48 newton to the power minus 3 sites per base per year. Now, what would this mean? This would necessarily mean that the virus would have possibly a fitness disadvantage because it cannot mutate as effectively as the other strains out there. And possibly this is why the virus sort of diminished, and over time it has sort of ceased to be present in the populations of sequences which are sequenced across the country. And as you see on the right side panel, you would see that A2A clade, which is in blue, has sort of dominated the landscape of genetic lineages now present across the country. The IA3I, which is in purple, mostly originated in February and March, and then again after a few months sort of evacuated the scene and was replaced by the A2A clade. And of course, there are multiple reasons this could have happened. One of the reasons could also have been early efforts of control, and of course the lockdowns which are put in place and restrictions for industry travel, which probably diminished the chance that this clade could survive and grow bigger. But of course, other than that, there could also be the fact that the virus mutates at a much lower rate, which essentially is a fitness disadvantage. Now, you could do this kind of a contact tracing at scale and also be able to trace the virus from state to state, and also how interstate travel could have contributed to the virus in terms of the introductions to each of the state, and of course, in the local epidemics at each of the states. I will not delve deep into this for lack of time, but moving forward, one of the major applications of looking at genetic variants in the genomes of SARS-CoV-2 is that it is a very useful approach to evaluate diagnostics for that matter, very specifically PCR or real-time PCR-based diagnostics. Now, practically all PCR-based diagnostics are built on the principle that you have oligonucleotide primers, which could recognize specific regions in the viral genome and amplify a small stretch of the viral genome, which are then probed by another set of oligonucleotide nucleotides to whom a fluorophore is attached. Now, the effectivity or efficacy of a PCR is dependent upon if the primer could bind very effectively to the nucleotide sequences out there. So in other words, if you have genetic mutations or genetic variations which map to these primer binding sites, which could adversely affect the binding or efficacy of binding, you could actually have a very ineffective PCR amplification, which could result in a false negative report. Now, what we did was very simple. We collected all the primers and probes from literature sources and, of course, package inserts of many of the diagnostic reagents, and mapped them back to the genome of SARS-CoV-2. And on top of it, what we did was to overlay the frequencies of genetic variations, which are likely to change the binding efficacy of these primers or probes. Now, what you see here in red are essentially the genetic variations which flow in one of the primer binding sites or the probe binding sites. And on the y-axis, what you see is the frequency of these genetic variations in global populations. In other words, what we suggest is that there are around 13 unique genetic variations, which is a frequency of more than 1% in global populations, which would mean that primers and probes designed which could cover these genetic variations are likely to be ineffective or are likely to produce more than 1% of false negative reports. The other interesting application of looking at SARS-CoV-2 genomes is to understand mechanisms of immune escape and also mechanisms of reactivation or reinfection. Now, briefly speaking, the immune system has two arms. You have the antibody-mediated or the B-cell-mediated arm, or the humoral response, and the T-cell-mediated or the cellular response. Now, both of these responses are important in viral infection and viral transmission, and the antibodies, of course, are widely assayed by serosurveillance. But what we are essentially talking about are genetic mutations in the virus, which could now change the binding domains for these antibodies, which could have implications. And one of these implications is possibly reinfections. Reinfections are essentially, reinfections by definition, infection of SARS-CoV-2 in an individual who has already been infected and who has been recuperated. So the initial two cases that we sort of described here was from the Government Institute of Medical Sciences, a tertiary care center in Noida, where two healthcare workers were actually picked up on routine surveillance. These two individuals had two episodes of infection and were hospitalized, and the timelines are sort of described in here. And the only way to sort of differentiate reinfection or prove reinfections in contrast to reactivation of persistent infection is to be able to sequence the genomes. And what you see here in the lower panel are essentially the sequences of episode 1 and episode 2 of the two individuals, I1 and I2. And what I highlight here are essentially the genetic variants in E1 and E2 are distinctly different from each other. In other words, these are two different viruses which infected these individuals. So this is one case where you could sort of prove reinfection, but a very similar case is what we call as reactivation. It's essentially when an individual gets an infection and over time the individual becomes negative for SARS-CoV-2 and at some point of time gets reactivated. And in fact, this is one of the probably only rare examples of genomically proven reactivation of SARS-CoV-2 reported in literature. And as you see here, between the E1 and E2, which are two episodes in this child who was suffering from neuroblastoma and on anti-cancer therapy, what you see here, and which is quite remarkable, is that the genetic variants in E1 and E2 are almost the same. In other words, these are essentially the same virus which sort of reactivated in this particular individual. I think that's pretty much for my talk. I will stop there. But before I stop, let me acknowledge a lot of people which made this possible. You heard about COVID-Sec, which was led by Sridhar and his team at IGIB, a fantastic set of young people. Most of the analysis was led by a dedicated set of people who worked really hard over the lockdown to put together resources and also analyze and make useful interpretations of this data, which includes Vani, Mercy, Kavita, Mukta, and many others like Abhinav and Disha. And this has not been possible unless we had quite good collaborators from across the country and a fantastic team of collaborators who are part of the IndiCovid Consortium. And of course, a number of people who made this possible, including Dr. Hafiz and a quite good collaborator, Dr. Divya Sokhati from our sister lab and the CCMB in Hyderabad. And as also Sridhar stated before, this would never have been possible without consistent support from CSIR in terms of grants, which made this possible and which made this sustainable. Thank you.
Over to you, Mr. Prashant.
Many thanks, Dr. Vinod and Dr. Sridhar, taking us through detailed insight on sequencing and how it is going to impact the multi-facet of the testing as well as maybe the viral escape. I don't know whether it is time to say that, but definitely some of the things what we hear from UK strain and South Africa strain, that these variations in, let's say, 502 aspergine to tyrosin, they are increasing a lot of spread. So infectivity is more, as well as I don't have an idea about the virulence of this new strain. So can you throw some insight on it?
While we talk about immune escape, we are essentially talking about antibody escape mechanisms. There are over 120 odd genetic mutations which individually have been tried on either monoclonal antibodies or in convalescent plasma, which has suggested that individually these mutations could contribute to immune escape. Now, in global populations, individual mutations in the population is not something that we should be really scared about because the immune response generated against SARS-CoV-2 is not monoclonal. It's not just one antibody that is produced, but also multiple antibodies in a polyclonal fashion, which could target the exposed proteins, typically the spike protein. So single mutations would not completely disrupt the immune response or the humoral immune response, but having said that, multiple of such escape mutations co-occurring on the spike protein could diminish significant amount of response, if not all, right? Now, fortunately, until today, we have not arrived at a combination of mutations which can escape the humoral response completely. But having said that, there have been very recent preprints as of yesterday, like, for example, the UK strain, which suggests that at least three of these escape mutations, the UK strain has three such escape mutations, could diminish the response to convalescent plasma in a significant way, but not, of course, completely.
So, yeah, please. Roshidhar, you want to add something?
No, not to this. I think Vinod has answered that very nicely. I do see a lot of questions on the Q&A. So how do you want to about Prashant to?
So definitely, I have noted them down. I can go through that one by one. So, or if you like, if you want to see, I'm skipping something and it is important to answer. I mean, one of you can simply answer that.
No, you can go ahead. One of the major questions. And we'll just answer all of them.
Yeah, so major section, what I see is like about COVID-SEC. One thing is like, is it possible to do on Amplicon using a MySeq? Maybe probably the viewer wanted to ask, like, even I designed my own setup primer designing like this regional spike and just check it out so that I could infer from his question. The other is like, how many samples you can actually pool when you are trying to, you know, sequence it and trying to find out, you know, a response. Third is, so these two probably
one,
to
one
start.
At a time. Yeah. Let me take it one at a time.
Yeah, certainly.
So better for me that I just go through the questions because they seem to be in an order. So the question is, using Illumina pipeline, could we only identify the SARS-CoV-2 variants and differentiate the UK, South Africa, and Brazil, et cetera, or does it only tell the presence of CoV-2 in general? So I have two parts to this, two answers to this question. The first part is that using the Illumina automated Dragon pipeline, okay, it will be able to tell you the presence of SARS-CoV-2 in form of a report, which is what is approved by FDA. Of course, like Vinod explained very nicely, additional analysis tools that have been put together by Vinod and team at IGAV, which is available now, can further dwell into the types of variants, differentiate between UK, South Africa, Brazil, etc. That has to be an add-on to this. Am I right, Vinod?
Yeah.
That's the two parts to the question. Okay. Second question is, should genome sequencing be done routinely for DX diagnostics of COVID or only to see evolution and find mutations of the virus or the as a new strain? Both. I think between Vinod's talk and my talk, we have really seen that as a diagnostics, it has its own advantages. Okay. In terms of doing genome sequencing in settings where it is possible. Of course, as an add-on to this, you can get the evolutionary history and the epidemiology for it, which is a very important component to beyond just diagnosis. Okay, so that's the answer for it. Third is, can we sequence viruses by custom generated amplicons on MySeq? This is what Prashant, you are referring to. Or is it only possible in RNA-seq library only? So using both COVID-seq amplicons, okay, which is nothing. So let me give you a little bit of a history of about how these amplicons got developed. They were developed in research labs across the world. One of the popular set of amplicons is called the Arctic protocol, which has a bunch of amplicons in it that was put out there in the public domain, upon which is a background on which the COVID-seq primers have been standardized, and they have been used nicely, and they have been standardized to a very smooth so that they can be operated smoothly. You can also generate your own personal customized amplicons and run them on the MySeq or the other sequencing platforms. It is amenable to the, we ourselves run COVID-seq in batches of 96 samples on the MySeq, and it works very nicely. Only is that some of the non-conventional methods, if you use, the analysis has to be customized. Okay, we have in-house analysis pipeline that we have put together with Vinod's help and other people who are around here. So we are able to make sense of it. You may not be able to use the standard pipeline that's coming with the Dragon server. Vinod, you can correct me if
you're absolutely right.
More.
You're absolutely
more.
Right.
Yeah.
No, please go ahead.
How can you find false negative RT-PCR? So essentially, when we do RT-PCR, usually the results come in if you have a very high CT value. Let's say a CT value of, if the kit IFU states that 35 is a cutoff and you cannot call beyond that, and you get 36, sometimes 40, okay, and such readings, okay, it becomes either inconclusives or negatives, okay? So we could use sequencing as a method to validate those and see what is the actual cutoff of the kit and be able to convert some of these so-called negatives into true positives. I think the next question is sort of related to it. I've answered that. So 8 to 10% false negativities with RT-PCR is very concerning. What is the PCR assay that it was compared with? Yes, it was very concerning to us also when we first noticed it. This could happen due to multiple reasons, not exclusively with the RT-PCR kit. It could also happen due to other reasons. But in this particular case, the RT-PCR that we compared it was done at the state levels from where we got the data, or the medical colleges where we got the data. So number of different kits that are popularly used have been employed. There is not one single kit that was used. Practically all the kits in the market had been put to use. So we would not be able to say which kit was it compared to. It was compared to, in general, the RT-PCR assay. So Vinod, you can take the next question. I'll read it out. Does sequencing of COVID-19 help us to design probes and primers for RT-PCR kit? For the mutated UK strain, how are the old primer probes reliable for diagnosis?
So one of the ways you can build better primers and probes is to design primers and probes in regions of the SARS-CoV-2 genome which are unlikely to have frequent genetic variations. So as I showed in the earlier map, the regions in the SARS-CoV-2 genomes which don't have frequent genetic mutations, and therefore you could build better primers and probes which are unlikely to be impacted by frequent genetic variants. Now, regarding the UK strain, the UK strain is not just one single genetic variant, but a compendium of genetic variants. The important genetic variants that we all discuss is the 501Y, which is on the spike protein. Now, fortunately or unfortunately, all the Indian diagnostics typically use the EN and the ORF1AP or the RDRP genes, not the spike. But having said that, there are also genetic diagnostics which use the spike protein. In fact, one of the commonly used diagnostic reagents in UK essentially came across this strain because it was noted that these are the spike fall-offs in the diagnostic. So yes, specific mutations can impact genetic diagnostics, but the only way you can circumvent this is to not use just one pair of primers, but of course primers expand multiple regions in the genome, which today is sort of a standard in RT-PCR diagnostics.
The next question, Vinod, is again, I'll leave it you to answer. On NovaSeq, what is the maximum limit of multiplexing? Do you think COVID-Seq, more multiplexing greater than 7 and 7 could be done? And what is the X coverage that should be considered?
Yeah, so in NovaSeq, typically you can multiplex up to 384 samples in one go. And of course, since there are multiple lanes, you could consider the multiples of 384. The coverage is quite enormous. On a standard NovaSeq run, 100 base pair or 150 base pair into two, you typically get around 10,000x coverage.
Yeah, the next is, could you please tell us the cost of sequencing 3,000 samples? The cost usually works to be somewhere around 2,000 rupees per sample if you run it in batches of 3,000. Remember, these are all economics of throughput. So in batches of 3,000, those numbers will hold up, 2,000 rupees will hold up. What is the cost of setting up this kind of a lab? That's the next question. Depending upon what is the scale and scope, you can go from, if you set up something like a NovaSeq, the NovaSeq machine itself costs you somewhere around 6 crore rupees plus the paraphilia around it. But if you set up something like a MySeq, those would come under a crore of rupees, but you could talk to the representatives of the company to get better estimates. What are the sites that are conducting sequencing for surveillance of the new strains in the country, and how is it done? Vinod, do you want to take this question?
Yeah, so as part of the new program, which is called INSACOG, which is rolled out by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, along with the DPT and many other institutions across the country, each state has been assigned to one or multiple labs where they could send samples of UK returnees. And as per the mandate, the ideal way to quantify is either by sequencing the spike protein or by whole genome sequencing. Most of the centers are actually doing whole genome sequencing.
You know, the next question is for you. Does SARS-CoV-2 genome sequencing surveillance program cover livestock, pets, and other animals?
Ideally, the answer is, if you ask the question globally, the answer is yes, and that's essentially how the Mink coronavirus was discovered. But as we go to India, I don't think it is covered by the other livestock and pets. But it's not a technical limitation, it is a logistic limitation.
So the next question is also for you. In case of reactivation, did you try to culture the virus, and can you confirm if the virus was viable and the patient was infectious?
No, we didn't confirm the virus by culture because one of the restrictions that the ethical committee put on the study was that we would never culture viruses from the sample isolates. So we could not do that.
There's a common question that I see on the time taken to sequence on mass scale. Like I told you, the minimum time that you could do it if you had everything going perfectly would be of the order of 12 hours. But I would, on a practical note, give you at least 24 hours from RNA to getting the analysis report. Okay, it should be a turnaround of 24 hours should be a very decent timeline that we should be able to meet. So the next question is, will SARS-CoV-2 genome be carried out at IGAB for foreseeable future? And what are the plans of sequencing the capacity at regional centers? I think Vinod has answered that question. INSACOG was set up through by Government of India for that very purpose. And we will at IGAB continue doing as long as it is required for the pandemic to subside. How much did the cost? We discussed about the cost. Yes, there's a question for me which says CT value. Okay, I think the person who posted this question probably got that slide wrong. So CT values below 22, okay, below 22 on an RT-PCR assay are the best, are the most ideal suited samples for doing genome sequencing on. They give you fantastic results. CT values up to 25, you get very good data, but not the ideal. You get decent data up to CT value 25. Beyond CT value 25 and all the way up to 30 that we tested, you would get parts of the genome coverages only, not the whole genome. Okay, I hope I answered the question. So, the next question, what is the role of sequencing post-COVID world when it becomes an endemic?
Yeah, so one of the things that I sort of mentioned early in the slide is that the genetic mutations in the virus is actually a matter of time. So the longer we have the virus circulating in the system, whether it is as part of endemicity, which is very likely, or as part of elimination process by giving vaccines, the fact is that the more time we take to do that, the virus mutates, and these mutations could be under different pressures. Like, for example, we're now talking about rolling out vaccines to subsets of individuals and then probably further to the entire population, a significant amount of people in the population. This is essentially immune pressure, and you should always keep in mind that the virus will mutate and you need to keep track of it. And the only way to keep track of such mutations is to be doing sequencing.
Yeah, I think that also relates to the question posted about impact of these mutations on available vaccines. So I guess you have answered that also. There are a number of questions again on the cost, which I have said, the on COVID seq assay that is put out by Illumina at the throughput of 3000 samples per run, it's about 2000 rupees per sample. There are other assays also available around the same sequencing assays, all revolving around that same cost.
Dr. Sridhar, it's like five, six already. So probably we can go through some couple of important questions. If you scroll down and feel like something important.
The rest of them are repeat questions of the same that we have. Unless, if you notice something that we have not already addressed, is there anything else?
No, mostly I see is the same pattern.
Yeah, I think pretty much we are done with the question answers.
Suddenly I see the...
At present, there are only a few COVID positive cases from Kurnool, Andhra Pradesh. But in July, there was a very high number of positive mainly due to N440K variant. What could be the reason? We know that's...
We also don't really know the reason because almost all this analysis is retrospective in the sense that we are looking at the virus much older in time. So all the conclusions can be that we sort of drive or derive on such genetic variants is also retrospective by looking at correlations. Like that is even true not just for N440 but also for the UK variant, because the UK variant emerged sometime in September and we are talking about the lockdowns and the restrictions in December. So it's all in retrospective to see what comes up and what goes down. But having said that, everything that goes up will also come down at some point of time.
Back to Dr. Prashant, I think we have pretty much covered. So there are some questions which are sort of deviating away into a different direction. I'm not going to take that in the interest of time.
Yes, certainly.
Yeah.
So indeed, a great question and answer session, which was presided by a great, very good talks by you both, giving a detailed perspective. And I think the participant has been benefited immensely because, you know, everybody is now talking about, so RT-PCR was there being talked, let's say 6 months back. Today, everybody is excited to learn something about sequencing and how it is going to shape up the future in case of pandemic management and in general as well. And probably the routine surveillance is going to be the key, which is like sequencing can be the best platform. And that was a good information that 5% of the samples are, you know, going to be routinely sequenced so that we have something to catch early. With that, I thank you, Dr. Sridhar, as well as Dr. Vinod for taking out your time and giving this insightful talk to the participant. It was a good learning even for me as well. I thank you both very much from the FIND side. Also thank to the participant for being over here and trying to learn something new. We will keep coming up with more such topics, maybe like new technologies if they are coming into the picture, or maybe in COVID-19 testing, something much simpler like biosafety or quality control measures in different testing scenarios. Till then, we say we will catch up maybe with our next webinar. Thank you very much. I wish you all the very best. And thank you to the speakers as well. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Prashant.
Great connecting. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.